Okay. So I want to start off by asking you all a question. Who really, really loves testing? It's hard to see, actually. There's a few. Yeah, well, I'm afraid those of us who do, we're about a small minority. For very many people, testing is more of a chore. It's something you have to do than something you really look forward to. So I want to think a little bit about why that is. Why is testing hard? Well, suppose you've got N features that you want to write tests for. You're going to write 3 or 4 tests per feature, right? And that's fine. That's a linear amount of work. No problem. But we all know that if you test features in isolation, you're not going to find all of your bugs. Some bugs only appear when you test 2 features together. So maybe we should test pairs of features. Oh dear, that's a quadratic amount of work. Doesn't sound so good. But then, even if you test all pairs of features together, you still won't find all of your bugs because some bugs only appear when you use 3 things together. That's a cubic amount of work. This is really starting to sound bad. And so far, we haven't even mentioned race conditions. Race conditions are, by definition, an interaction between at least 2 features. And they don't even appear every time you run a test. So, this is hair-tearingly difficult. So this is the problem with testing. This is why testing is hard. You can't test everything. When are you going to stop? So what's the answer? Don't write tests. Generate them. So I'm going to talk about a test generation tool called QuickCheck that I've been working with for almost 15 years. Kuhn Klassen and I invented the first version way back in 1999, and we wrote it in Haskell. You can play with that today. Some of you will know it, I expect. And since 2006, then I've been working with an Erlang version, which is the one I'm going to show you today. And we've had a whole lot of fun applying it to find deep bugs in all kinds of different kinds of software. So what does QuickCheck do in the most common use? Well, we have some API that we want to test, and we generate random test cases that are sequences of calls to the API. And we keep doing that until one of them fails. And when a test fails, especially a randomly generated test, it's not usually because of everything in that test case. Usually a test fails just because of a few of the API calls that we made. So the next thing that QuickCheck does is do a search and try and identify those few responsible calls and simplify the test case down to a minimal failing example. And that's what we report to the user. I'm going to show you an example of testing with QuickCheck. I'm going to use a circular buffer in C. And I hope that I will be able to... Okay, now I'm going to have to... Okay, whoa. That wasn't really what was supposed to happen. Oh, there it is. Good. No. Okay.
Clone. Oh, it's just like, okay.
Ah, there we are. Okay, so I'm going to test a circular buffer written in C. So let me just demonstrate the API to you. Here is my C read eval print loop. And I'm going to, first of all, create a buffer or a queue. Let's create one of size 3. Whoa. What happened there? I forgot to compile my C code.
Oh.
I don't think so.
It helped. Oh dear, you can't lower.
No, I can't go that low. Oh.
So maybe we should.
Okay, it's disappearing. There it is.
Okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Good.
Okay. Okay. So now I can show you the API. So I will first of all create a buffer of room for 3 elements. And that returns a pointer. Let's put a 1 into the buffer. It just contains integers. Let's put 2 in. I can ask how many elements are in the buffer at the moment. 2, of course. And I can get items from the buffer. There's the 1. There's the 2. There's the uninitialized memory. No wussy exceptions for us. This is C. We just keep right on going. There's the 1 again. There's the 2 again. Uninitialized memory. And so on. So you get the picture. So, the way that we test this kind of stuff in QuickCheck, as I was explaining, is we generate test cases that are a sequence of API calls, and we specify what they should do by using what we call a state machine model. So, a test case is going to look something like that, and then we specify the behavior in terms of a model state, and we specify for each operation in the test case, how that changes the model of the state, and then we write post conditions for each operation that check the results. And all of this code in the model, that's Erlang code in our case. So even though I'm going to be testing C code, then the specification of what it's supposed to do is written using Erlang, and I can use nice declarative libraries and so on. So in this case, a test case might do something like this. Put 1, put 2, get, put 3, and so on. Well, how can I model the contents of the circular buffer? Very simple. Let me just use a list of the values that I think should be in the buffer at the moment. So we start off with an empty list. After putting a 1, then there should be just one element. After putting a 2, there should be a list with 2 elements. So that's a very simple model in Erlang of what the C code is doing. And then the post conditions will just check that get always returns the first value from the list of values that ought to be there. What does the code look like? I've got some fragments here. This is the specification of get. And we write specifications by defining a number of small functions whose names are related to the name of the thing we're specifying. So this is the precondition. And it talks about the model. What it says is that the pointer must not be undefined. That is, you've got to call new before you call get. That makes sense. And the contents, that's this list of values that should be in the queue, must not be empty. So that's the precondition. What's the effect of get? Well, it replaces the contents by the tail of the list, so it discards the first element. And what's the post condition? It just says the result that get returns must be the first element of the list. So we don't need to study this in detail. It's just, I just want to show you how short and simple the code is. Let's run some tests then. So if I come back to my LM shell, if that works, there it is. The way that I run tests is, first of all, remember to compile my model, and then I'll just call quick check, and I'll pass it my property of Qs. And, whoa, a test failed. So what happened there was that quick check generated a random test case. Whoa, it's all this stuff. No, it's not. It's higher up than that. Oh, well. And then it shrank it down. So shrinking means that quick check is searching for a simpler example, and we end up with this. So what happened? I created a queue of size 1, and that returned a pointer. I put 0 into it. Well, that was okay. And then I asked for the size. Let's see. I put one thing into the queue. How many things should be in there? 1. And size returned, 0. Okay, so there seems to be something wrong with my code. But I tested size, you saw me do it a few minutes ago, and it seems to be working, but something is wrong. Let's have a look at the code itself. Okay, let's move this over a little. Oh, stop it. So here's my C code, and you can see that I've defined a struct to represent the queue. There's an input pointer that's incrementing and an output pointer. This is a pointer to where I keep the data. Here's how I create a new queue. And down here, this is how I put something in. Okay, I write the value that I'm putting into the buffer at the input pointer, then I increment the input pointer modulo the size. And what is the size? It's 1. So here, when I put something into the queue, which I just did, I incremented the initial value, that's 0. That's 1 modulo 1. But 1 modulo 1 is 0 again. Oh dear, so if I've got a queue of size 1, and I put one thing into it, my input pointer wraps around, back to the beginning. And when I ask what the size, the number of elements in the queue is, I just take the difference between the input and output pointers, that's 0 minus 0, modulo 1, that's 0. It's always going to be 0. If my queue is of size 1, then size is always going to return 0. Well, that doesn't make sense. How should I fix it? Okay, I'll show you. This is a really nice hack. The problem here is that it's not just for queues of size 1. If I make a queue of size n and then put n things into it, it's a circular buffer, so my input pointer wraps around. So a full queue looks exactly the same as an empty queue. My representation can't distinguish them. So I'm going to have to change my representation. And what I'm going to do is, because this bug only appears when the queue is full, then when I'm asked to create a queue of size n, I'm going to create one of size n plus 1. Don't tell anybody. Now, if anybody sees my bug, it's because they put n plus 1 things into a queue of size n. And what does that mean? It means it's their fault. I have successfully avoided blame, which is the goal of all good software engineering. Let me recompile my C code, and then I can just rerun the last test like this, and it passes. Okay, but maybe I should still run some more tests. Let's run some more random tests. Oh no, something else went wrong. Okay, now I want you to debug this. what happened here? I made a queue of size one, that's really two. I put one thing into it and I took it out again. Okay, so now the queue's empty. So now I'm allowed to put a second thing into it, aren't I? And then I ask, how many things are in there? Okay, I put something in, I took it out, I put another one in. How many things should be in the queue? One. And what does size say? Minus one. What? What happened? Here's my size function. What on earth went wrong? Can anybody debug that? I made a queue of size one. That's really two. I put two things into it. What happened? The input pointer wrapped around, back to zero. I took one thing out. The output pointer was incremented to one. So here I took zero minus one, that's minus one, but modulo two. What's minus one modulo two? Plus one, obviously. Let's try it. Minus one modulo two. It's minus one. It's the wrong answer. So Erlang doesn't give me modulo, it gives me remainder, which gives me a different answer, and so does C. So the problem with this code is that if this difference is negative, then the modulo does the wrong thing and I get the wrong answer. So to fix this, I've got to make sure that that expression is always positive or never negative. How can I do that? Absolute value, obviously. There we are, so let's put that in. And I'll recompile my C code and rerun the last test, and it passes. Now, I want you to think about what I've done. I revealed a rather tricky bug. I created a test case that demonstrated the bug existed. I've patched my code. My test passes. All my tests are green. I'm done, right? Shall I run some more random ones? OK. Darn, it still doesn't work. Let me run one more. Oh, okay, so what happened here? I created a queue of size two, that's really three. I put three things into it. Okay, so the input pointer wrapped around again. I took one thing out, three things in, one thing out. How many items are in the queue? Two. And so Sai says, one? One is not equal to two. What went wrong here? Well, here, the input pointer wrapped around, so I took zero. The output pointer, I'd taken one thing out, so that's one. Zero minus one, that's minus one. Absolute value is plus one. That's why I got plus one. But actually, absolute value changes its argument modulo the size. So I shouldn't do that. That was the wrong thing to do. It fixed the bug that in the test case I'd found, but it didn't fix it in general. In general, what I need to do is make sure this value is positive without changing its value modulo size. And I can do that by adding on Q size, an extra one. That'll never be negative. And when I take it modulo size, it just cancels that thing that I don't want. And now, if I recompile that and rerun the last test, it passes. And if I run random tests, now at last they pass. Okay, so just notice here that the randomly generated tests I was running, they were long and complicated. You wouldn't want to debug those things. But in every case, QuickCheck reduced it down to a simple test case that just contains the necessary operations to make the test fail. And I hope you'll agree that those were quite easy to debug. So what are we seeing? So we've seen that the same tests, the same property, could find many different bugs. I found three different bugs for you today. And also these minimal failing tests, they make diagnosing the bug really very easy. And we think of the shrinking process as like extracting the signal from the noise of random tests. Random tests tend to be long and full of junk. That is their purpose. But you don't want to diagnose one of those things when it goes wrong. What you want to do is to isolate the cause of the failure, extract the signal, and once you've done that, then debugging is easy. And the great thing about a tool like QuickCheck is that it can not only provoke the fault, but also simplify the test case. All of us have spent far too many hours simplifying test cases manually. It's great to have it done for you. Okay, so I've demonstrated QuickCheck on a very tiny toy example. You might wonder, does it work for real? Well, for the past few years, we've been doing some work for Volvo Cars, testing part of the Autosar basic software. This is software that runs on the processors in cars. A car nowadays will have 50 to 100 processors, and all of them run the basic software. It's not the application that controls the engine or opens and closes the windows. It's stuff like an Ethernet stack, the CAN bus stack. The CAN bus is commonly used for communicating between the processors in cars, and other stuff. So there's a whole bunch of basic software. Every processor is supposed to run it. But you might think, OK, so then the problem is you want to be sure that the basic software on all the nodes will work together. So how will you ensure that? Well, you'd have one open source project to develop one implementation that runs on all the processors, right? That is not what the car industry has done. Rather, there are many different suppliers of this basic software, and there's a standard that specifies how they're supposed to behave. So that's great, right? That means that as a car manufacturer, you can buy the software from whatever provider is most convenient for the component you're talking about, and just put it all together, and it all works seamlessly. That's the point of a standard. Well, guess what? That often doesn't happen. And when it doesn't happen, it's a nightmare for the system integrator, for, you know, the car company like Volvo, because they can't even tell whose software is doing the wrong thing. And so they hired us to develop quick check specifications for large parts of the basic software and to run tests on the code that they were buying. Here's one of the bugs we found. This is a bug in a CAN bus stack. So the CAN bus carries messages that have priorities. The lower the number of the priority, the higher the priority for the bus. So this test case sends a message with priority one, and then, so we send the message and we see that it's sent on the bus. The bus can only carry one message at a time though, so the next two calls to send message, those messages get queued up. The last call in this test case is a transmission confirmation. That's usually called from the bus driver. And it says, I've finished sending message number one. Which message should be sent next by the protocol stack? The one with priority? Two. And which one was sent? The one with priority three. I can show you why this happened, because we actually debugged this. It turns out that the priorities are, they're also used as message identifiers. And in the first version of the CAN bus standard, there was 11 bits for the message identifier. But that only allows 2,000 different kinds of message in the entire car. It's just not enough. So the new version of the standard also allows extended CAN IDs of 29 bits. What's that? That's about around about 500 million different message IDs. That's enough so far. But of course, the bus protocol has to accept both kinds of identifiers. So in this particular protocol stack, the CAN ID was stored in an unsigned 32-bit integer. And so that the protocol stack could use the correct format, it has to remember, is it extended or not? Well, you only need 29 bits, even for the extended ID. So this stack used the top bit to indicate an extended CAN ID. Which means when you're trying to decide which message to send, you have to remember to mask off that bit. Guess what? The one with priority two had an extended CAN ID. So the stack treated it as priority 2 to the 31 plus 2. And thus it got sent last. So that's the explanation for why this bug happened. And I really like this bug, partly because it shows that using this approach, we have had a really low-level bug failing to mask off a bit in some real-time C code. But nevertheless, there's a short test case that provokes it, and we could find that short test case by generating random cases and shrinking. The mechanism that I just showed you worked fine. The other reason I like it is you might say, well, does it really matter? What's a few priorities between friends? But remember, everything in the car talks on the CAN bus. The stereo, the brakes. Here's a tip, don't adjust the volume during emergency braking. So finding this bug really mattered. So we did a lot of work on this stuff. We read the standard 3,000 pages of PDFs. We turned that into 20,000 lines of quick check code. 20,000 lines is much more than I showed you, but it was the same kind of code. It wasn't really hugely hard. We tested 1 million lines of C code from 6 different suppliers, and we found more than 200 problems in the C code, of which more than 100 were problems in the standard itself. So those have been fed back into the Autosar consortium now, and there's a whole lot of cleaning up has happened because we identified places where the standard was inconsistent. And we also found, when we were able to compare our test code to existing test code, that our code was 10 times smaller than a conventional test suite and tested more. So that's a win. So that's the largest quick check project that there's been so far. But I also want to tell you a story I'm very proud of, which begins with a message to the Erlang mailing list. So this concerns testing Erlang code. So about 7 years ago, there was a message sent to the Erlang list. We know there's a lurking bug somewhere in the DETS code. We got bad object and premature end of file every other month the last year. But we haven't been able to track the bug down because the file is repaired automatically next time it's opened. So this was a message from Tubbe Turnquist at Klarna, and I'm sure that we all feel Tubbe's pain. But what's the context? Well, Klarna is a Swedish company that started up in the mid-2000s and provides invoicing services for web shops. It sounds boring, but it was a super idea. Nowadays, they're more than 1,000 people, and they're serving 7 European countries. They're going from strength to strength. They built their application in Erlang, using as their database, Manesia, the database that is delivered together with Erlang, that provides distribution, transactions, replication, lots of good stuff. But it needs a back end to store its data. And there are several back ends. The one that stores data on disk is called DETS. That provides tuple storage in files. And DETS is the component that Tubbe Turnquist was talking about. And when I heard about this, and I heard that it was crashing every month or so, I thought, that sounds like a race condition. That would be interesting to go after. So let me tell you, now I have to move from the sublime to the ridiculous and show you the approach that we use for testing for race conditions. I want to imagine that I want to test one of these. Does everybody recognize this? You have them in Poland? Yeah, good. We have them in Sweden. We're very good at queuing in Sweden. So every bakery or delicatessen counter will have one of these things, so each customer can take a ticket. So suppose I wanted to model that in Erlang. Well, I'd have to provide an operation for taking a ticket, and what else happens? Well, every now and then, the ticket roll runs out, and somebody comes along and replaces it. So let's have a reset operation as well. And now, I want to test these operations. Well, I could write a unit test, quite simply. Here's one, with the way you might write it in Erlang. So the red bit, that is pattern matching the result of the calls. So reset must return OK, that's a constant in Erlang. Take ticket, the first call must return 1, the second must return 2, and so on. So you get an idea of what these operations are supposed to do. And it's also very easy to model these operations in QuickCheck. I won't show you the code that does it, but I just define a state machine model like the previous one, simplicity itself. The problem is that I don't think this unit test captures everything I want to test about that dispenser's behavior. Why? Because the purpose of a dispenser is to regulate the flow of a lot of concurrent customers to one bakery counter. And if I only run tests like this, sequential tests, then I'm failing to test for the concurrent behavior. So what I really want to do is not just run tests like this, which everybody knows how to write, but run parallel unit tests, like this one. So here's a test in which, first of all, we reset the ticket dispenser, and then one customer comes along and takes two tickets for some reason, and at the same time as another customer comes along and takes a ticket. So we know how to write unit tests, right? We take the results and we compare against expected results. What are the expected results in this case? Well, we might see this, where the customer on the left gets ticket one and two. Or we might see this, where the customer on the right kind of leaps in between the first customer's two attempts to take a ticket and gets ticket number two. That's maybe a little rude, but it's correct behavior, isn't it? What we must not see is this, where both customers get ticket number one. So parallel testing is awkward because there's not one correct answer. So how do we write the unit test? Well, we could, of course, write a test that captured all of the results and then just checks to see that we got one, two, and three in some order. Or we could check against each of the three possible correct outcomes. But enumerating the correct outcomes doesn't scale. Right, this test has three possible correct outcomes, but it's a tiny test. I really want to run tests like this one instead. How many correct outcomes does this test have? Too many. There are actually 30 possible correct outcomes. So enumerating the expected results just doesn't scale for parallel testing. The only practical way to write parallel tests is to write some kind of property that can distinguish a correct result from a wrong one. So it's a killer app for property-based testing. Let me show you how we do it. Here's the first test I showed you, but I've drawn it on its side now. I claim that this is correct behavior. How can I tell that? Well, because there is some order in which I could have performed those calls that would make the results match my sequential model. So that's what we do. We generate and run parallel tests, and for each test we say, could we have arranged these in a sequential order and got something that matched the model? I've got an implementation of that here. Let's see what happens when I test it. Okay, I better compile my dispenser. And now the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to run the sequential model to run sequential tests. That's what this line is doing. And they pass. And what that shows is that my model matches the implementation. Let me run some parallel tests. Whoa, one of them failed. If I make two parallel calls to take ticket, they both returned one. That's clearly wrong. Now I want you to notice that, first of all, we did something random, which was quite complex, and then we shrank it down to this simple example. This is the test that we want to debug. Let me just run that test again. It's random, so we had a different starting point that failed, but we shrank it down to the same minimal example. Look, it happens pretty often, doesn't it? So the point here is just that the shrinking is very, very effective, even for race conditions. Okay. So now I'm going to show you, if the picture comes back. Yes. Oh, good. I'm going to show you the code that I was running. That's my code for taking a ticket. Read and write a global variable. wait a minute, that's a critical section. Where's the synchronization code? There isn't any. No wonder it doesn't work. My point here is not, oh look, we found a very subtle and difficult to find race condition. My point is, here is a completely obvious race condition. We find it quickly and reliably. This is the ridiculous, let's go back to the sublime. Testing dets. So what does dets do? It's a tuple store. In a file, you store a collection of tuples. They look like this in Erlang. The first component is a key. And there are operations to insert a list of tuples into the table, to delete all the tuples with a given key. Insert new is like insert, but if any of the keys is already present, then it's a no-op and it's atomic. And there's a bunch of other stuff. It won't surprise you. So it's quite a simple API. It's very easy to model. It's almost as simple as just saying, let's model the contents of the table as a list of the tuples that ought to be there, just like my queue. It's so simple that I could write a quick check model of the core of the DETS API in less than 100 lines of code. But the implementation is more than 6,000 lines spread across four modules. So there's a pretty good ratio of test code size to implementation size here. And now I want you to remember that this is a core part of the database you get with Erlang. It had been in production more than 15 years when I started doing these tests, and it's heavily used in Erlang applications. So I wrote a quick check model. I began running tests. I had to correct a few misconceptions on my part, but I finally got a sequential model that matched the implementation. And then I ran parallel tests. And immediately, I found this. Okay, so first of all, we opened the file, and then we did two things in parallel. We inserted an empty list of tuples. That's a no-op. And I called insert new to insert another empty list of tuples. That's another no-op. They both returned okay, but QuickCheck says there's no way to explain this using the model. How is that possible? Looks okay, doesn't it? Sometimes there's no alternative. You just have to read the manual. There's what it says about insert new. Look at the result type. Bool. Even in Erlang, a bool is either true or false. It's not okay. So the funny thing is, I ran tens of thousands of tests sequentially, and it returned true or false every single time. I ran a parallel test, and suddenly it returned okay. Where did that come from? Oh, well, so I went on. A moment later, I found this one. This is kind of similar. First of all, we open the file, and then in parallel, we do an insert and insert new of a tuple with a key of zero and a value of zero. So that second, the insert new, it might succeed or it might fail, depending on whether it goes first or second. But it ought not to time out. And we ought not to see this message. DETS, bug was found when accessing table. So when I saw that, I was pretty confident that there was a bug in DETS. Well, so I kept going. Here's the third one. I found all of these within a few minutes. So what's happening here? To begin with, we open the file, and then we do two things in parallel. One process opens the file again. You might think that's odd. But remember, Erlang is designed for highly concurrent systems. We expect very many processes to be using the table at the same time, and all of them have to make sure it's open. So it's quite okay for one process to open the table while another is using it. What does the second process do? It inserts 00, and then it fetches the entire contents of the table, and it contains nothing. What happened to the 00? I just put that in. Well, I found this bug in several different forms. Basically, while one process was opening the table, then another one might see a sequentially inconsistent view of its contents. So I was quite pleased with myself, and I sent these bug reports off to the man at Ericsson that was maintaining the code, and he sent me back a debugged version. He said, thank you very much. Nice you found these, but I don't think these are the errors they're getting at Klarna. At Klarna, the file is being corrupted. And I hadn't really tested for that. So I asked the guy at Ericsson how I could tell if the file is corrupt, and he gave me one line of code to test that. I added it to my test code, and I ran more tests. This time I had to run for 5 to 10 minutes. And I found this. So in this test case, before going parallel, we open the file, we close it, we open it again. Then we do three things in parallel, two insertions and a lookup. Everything returned values that are consistent with my model, but when I checked for corruption, I got premature end of file. I saw this and I thought, come on, this can't be a minimal failing test. I mean, open, close, open, it doesn't make any sense. It must be enough just to open the file. So I manually simplified this test case to just open the file in the prefix there. And I ran it tens of thousands of times, and it passed every single time. And today I know why. Because at the start of the test, the file does not exist. That first open creates the file. Then we close it. The second open opens an existing file. It's very slightly different. And that difference is critical to provoking the race condition. Likewise, you really have to do three things in parallel to hit that race. So I sent that off to Hasselbelinda, the guy maintaining the code, and he sent me back a fixed version. And I was really pleased with this story. I mean, this test case, I love. I think this is a test case that can only be found by generating tests. Nobody in their right minds would write that in their test suite. There are 12 different operations in the API. Think how many test cases there are with 6 calls. Why would you write this one? So it can only be found by this method, I believe. So I was supposed to give a talk at a conference in Denmark about something else, but I thought this story was much nicer. So I began preparing my slides, but I hadn't unfortunately saved the output. So I had to rerun my tests in my hotel room and copy and paste onto my slides. And as I was doing that, I found this one. Here we are, we open a file, we insert 1-0 into it, and then we do two things in parallel. One process reopens the file again, the other looks up something that's not there and then deletes the thing that is. And when I checked for corruption, I got bad object. There's the message from the mailing list. Bad object and premature end of file every other month for last year. The symptoms are the same. I sent that off to the man maintaining the code the next day. He sent me the fixed version. And there's now a lot of evidence. This fixed version has been in production at Klarna for quite some time now, more than a year. And since it was put into production, there's been one bad object exception, which happened when reading a file that was last written before the new code went into effect. So it looks as though these really were the bugs that were happening. Before I did this work, then more than 6 weeks of effort had gone into trying to pin these problems down. And the best theories were, it seems to happen when the file is around 1 gigabyte. Maybe it's something to do with rehashing. Now we know you need a database with at most one record, and you need either 5 or 6 calls to provoke the bug. And in each case, given that minimal failing example, it took less than a day to find and fix the code. So I think this is a very strong demonstration, both of the power of shrinking and generating tests, and of how hopeless it is to try and debug race conditions from failures that happen in production, when not only the 5 or 6 things that matter have happened, but billions of irrelevant stuff as well. So, my conclusion, property-based testing finds more bugs with less effort. Don't write tests, generate them. Thank you. Have we time for questions?
When you're, like your example with the buffer, was that you are sort of re-implemented part of the logic again as a property base, as a property.
Yes, you might say that. So we always try to avoid too much duplication of code and ideas between the model and the implementation. If you just write the same code twice, then it's not going to help you find bugs. But you shouldn't think too much about that simple circular buffer example. Think about the debts case, where the production code is 6,000 lines, it's managing hash tables in files on the disk, and the specification is just a tiny little piece of code that's manipulating a few lists. You want that kind of big difference between the implementation and the model, then you really gain a lot.
Hello. I'm wondering, where do you see property-based checking in relation to formal verification, such as Koch and ACTA? Is this like a fuzzier, semi-formally verified, how do you see the relationship there evolving over the next 10 years or so?
So they have in common that you verify against a formal specification. Right? When we write the quick check model, it's a formal spec. We may call it something different, but it is a formal spec, basically. The difference is that whereas verifying your program against the formal spec with Koch or ACTA, that involves writing a whole lot of proofs. And the proofs are about an order of magnitude more expensive to construct than the source code. If you're using property-based testing, you push a button. So there's a huge difference in cost. Property-based testing, I'm convinced, is cheaper than ordinary testing, whereas formal verification is far more expensive. Now, if you really want to use formal verification also, writing proofs is a very, very good way to demonstrate that your code really matches the specification, but it's a very, very expensive way to find out that it doesn't. So if you're going to try and prove something correct, you really want to have tested it very thoroughly first, so that you're trying to prove something that is actually true. That's always easier. So I think the two methods can complement each other. But unfortunately, formal verification at the moment is so expensive that it's, for some time to come, it's going to be confined to places where the cost of the software and the time to delivery doesn't matter anything like as much as guarantees that the verification can give you.
Like, would you suggest to use the tool for the projects where you don't have the kind of payments, reactors, and so on, but for just simple stuff? Like, is it easy to write the specs you do, or is it would be easier to write just like kind of simple ones that we usually write and we don't actually rely 100% that the code should be correct?
Well, that depends on how many simple tests you're going to write. So I use QuickCheck every time I'm writing code. And I guess writing the properties, it's a skill that needs to be learned. It's something that, unfortunately, we don't really teach very well in universities at the moment. But if you learn it, then you get so much power because your bugs are found immediately for you that, you know, I wouldn't want to waste my time writing tests one by one when I can write a generator that will generate tens of thousands for me automatically. My experience is, when I'm developing code myself, I'll write the properties first, and then I'll write the code, and QuickCheck is merciless. I don't get away with making it almost work. I have to make the code really, really work. And when I do that, if I've misconceived something, I find out very quickly. And once I've finished and I've got code that passes the tests, then it's very, very rare that I have to go back to it a week later and fix something, because I found all of the problems to begin with. Sometimes what happens is, I write the properties, and I write the code and it fails, and I realize, oh, the properties aren't quite right, and I have to make them a little bit more complicated. And I run more tests and they fail, and I say, oh, I have to fix the code, and it gets a little more complicated. And I run more tests, and they say, oh, I have to change the properties, and they get a little bit more complicated. So I think what happens then is I get into this feedback loop where the properties and the code are both getting more and more complicated. And you know what that tells me? Go back to the drawing board. I'm trying to do the wrong thing. So a kind of subtle benefit of using this approach all the time is that I think you discover places where your design is wrong earlier. You're forced to go back to the drawing board earlier, and that's a good thing.
So is there any strategy for figuring out how long you should let Quick Check run?
Something that I haven't had time to show you in any detail is that we collect statistics about the tests that we're running. So one danger with property-based testing is you don't see the test cases. What if you're generating millions of trivial tests? Then you could end up with a false sense of security. So it's very important to capture statistics that tell you things like how often each operation is being tested, maybe if operations can be invoked in different ways, how often was each, you know, did each case occur? And once we have a good distribution of tests, and we'll also look at source code coverage to see are we testing as thoroughly as we think, then, well, I certainly wouldn't settle for the 100 tests you've seen here, but 10,000 tests or 100,000 tests, that gives quite a good level of confidence.
Would you use that in production now after you have tested it?
Sure, yes, and maybe I'll even buy a Volvo.
Okay, thank you. And another question is, when you're generating the test, are you using some kind of, for example, Markov model, where you have different weights of the next step, or is it just plain distribution of probability?
Oh, so we write test data generators. We have a library, an API for doing that, which makes it quite simple. And of course, one of the things that we can do is assign weights to different alternatives. We think about how we generate data. For example, for some kind of tests, you might want random sorted lists. And this is something that people sometimes worry about. You know, if you generate a random list, what's the probability that it's going to be sorted? Well, very low. So you could end up throwing away an awful lot of test data. Here's how to generate a random sorted list. Generate a random list and sort it. So if you just think about how you're generating test data and do it sensibly, then you can get very good distributions. But don't think of this as, you know, a black box that it just generates tests and everything is fine. You still have to think about what tests you want to run, think about what distribution you want, but instead of thinking about your tests one by one, you think about them thousands at a time. So think of it as amplifying your own intelligence in designing your tests, rather than something that is, you know, purely just put the code in there and the answers will come out.
I want to ask about applicability of Quick Check, because with traditional manual testing, you know that for a legacy code base, it's sometimes hard to add tests because there are no seams to put tests in. But so if you're writing a Quick Check test, are there any obstacles in that you would be able to write a traditional manual test but not a Quick Check test?
So as you say, there can be difficulties in writing tests at all. You maybe need to expose a bit more of an internal API, for example, so that you can write tests at all. But once you can do so, once you can write one test, you can usually write several, right? And if you can write, it's unlikely that you're going to do something to your code that enables you to write exactly four tests. So if you can potentially write a whole collection of tests, why not generate them? And you'll save yourself time and effort by doing so. Okay, maybe we're getting ready for the party. I just thought I would tell you where you can find out more. You can, of course, look at the Haskell Quick Check. There's a paper from 2000 that explains how that early version worked. Cubic Quick Check. That's the tool that I've demonstrated. It's something that our company produces and works with. And there are many, many other tools that have been inspired by QuickCheck. So there's quite a good chance that your favorite language has a port of Quick Check that you could try playing with.
I just have a quick question. Here on your left. Right here. Hello.
Hi.
I think Quick Check and property-based testing work extremely well where the tests are extremely fast, right? You can run 10,000 tests in less than a second. I think this is a little bit related to the previous question. You know, like what if the system is kind of slow? It like talks over the network or does I/O, and you can't do quite as many tests at a time. Do you have any recommendations, or have you encountered that at all? That your run of Quick Check takes minutes or hours or.
Last week we ran some Quick Check tests on Dropbox, and each test would take maybe 10 to 20 seconds. So we had to wait quite a while to find out that Dropbox create conflict files in a rather surprising and counterintuitive way. But we were still able to shrink the problem down to a little test case. And I think it's still, I don't know how else we would have discovered that property. One of the early examples we did was I worked with a telecom company on testing radio base station. And we found that one of our tests crashed the base station completely, which meant that you couldn't run another test until you rebooted it. And this was these were the shiny new fast base stations, but they still took 2 minutes to reboot. So what we had to do was write a Quick Check property that rebooted the base station at the beginning of each test and go for a long lunch. And when we came back, we discovered that there's a message that you could send the base station to tell it what frequencies to use for the so-called signaling channel that talks to all the phones in the cell. So you're setting up that channel with this message. You shouldn't send the message twice because there can only be one signaling channel. If you do, the base station should reject it. But for just the right combination of parameters, the base station software in that case accepted the second one, set up two channels where, fundamentally there can only be one. And then shortly afterwards, the whole base station fell over. That was really kind of fun to debug because when we looked in the base station logs, we found they were full of Java exceptions. But we knew the base station was built with C++. It turned out there was an operator GUI that tried to visualize what was happening in the base station. And that was the first thing that fell over when there were two of these channels where there should only be one. The C++ code, that just kept going happily until it completely crashed. But the operator GUI that detected the error quite early on. So, we found a potentially very serious bug in the base station in only the time it takes to eat a long lunch. That's a win. So system testing with Quick Check is slower, but I think it's still well worth it. Any more questions? Time for beer.